Hello, and welcome back to The Wrinkle. Today we're going to talk about transitions. We're going to talk about transitions in the context of responsive behaviors in dementia. So one of the things I love about being a geriatrician is the hours. Most geriatric assessments take place during the day at a reasonable time. The outpatient work is all scheduled and organized, so my lifestyle is very manageable, even though the work is not always easy. I'm not waking up in the middle of the night to deal with emergencies. But when I do get urgent phone calls, it's often around a person who's living with dementia who's going through a transition. And the most common transition is that of going from living at home to living in long-term care. Let me share the story of Herman and Maria. Herman and Maria had been married for 43 years. They lived in the home that they raised their family in. Their kids did live out of town, so Maria was pretty much doing everything that was needed to do for Herman's care, along with some community supports. Herman was medically complex. He had severe osteoarthritis of his knees. He hadn't been a candidate for knee replacement surgery, so moving was really painful and difficult from that point of view. He also had heart failure, which caused him to be short of breath when he exerted himself too much. And for the last year, Herman had pretty much been living in the upstairs floor of the couple's home, where there was a bathroom, but the kitchen and everything else was downstairs. So Maria was pretty much making things happen so that he could stay in the home. It was really challenging. And Maria actually just couldn't do it anymore because she got a diagnosis of cancer. It was time for Herman to go to long-term care. But he steadfastly refused. Herman was living with dementia on top of his medical complexities, and it was hard for him to appreciate the limitations that he was currently living with, as well as the limits of what Maria was able to support. He had actually become verbally and physically responsive even when that was brought up before. So it was a big challenge as to how are we going to get Herman to long-term care, which was really where he needed to be. There was a lot of discussion, and I remember we even had discussions about do we need to give Herman some heavy tranquilizers and somehow get him down the stairs. He was a very heavy set gentleman. It wasn't going to be easy to move him. We would probably need multiple paramedics to move him if he was unconscious and not able to help with that transfer. It just was really challenging to think about how that was going to operationalize. In the end, Herman was able to go to long-term care with some planning, and we did have to use a fiblet, which I'll tell you a little bit more about later. But these transitions are challenging, and so I was really excited when I saw a tool that has been developed by the Behavioural Supports Integrated Team Collaboration. So what are the four critical elements for getting someone to long-term care in the best way possible? Well, number one is to involve the person and the family members in every stage of the transition. So that's before, during, and after. And that's good for us to hear as clinicians, because sometimes we have discussions amongst ourselves and we make assumptions about what that would mean for the family or for the person who's living with dementia. So having it explicit that the family and the person need to be involved, I think is excellent. Number two, communication between the sending site and the receiving site, which is almost always long-term care. That information needs to be current and needs to be timely. Thirdly, the plan for the transition needs to be individualized. There's no one size fits all. That's true of almost everything in healthcare, but especially when it comes to a senior who's living with dementia, who has responsive behaviors, the plan has to be very individualized. And there are actually lots of tools that we can use to try to develop an individualized plan. Finally, there needs to be the identification of a lead for every step of the transition. So it could be the care coordinator who is involved in the community care. And that person or their delegate does have to be available, because sometimes these changes happen at short notice. So it is really important to designate that person. It's also good to have a lead from the family, because the Maria in this case might not be the best person to be the lead. Maybe it's her son. If you look at the document, which I will link to down below, it's actually got many, many practical tools and pieces of advice that I think will be helpful. Will every transition be smooth and seamless? No. But I think the fact that these guidelines, that this checklist is out there for us to look at and use, is a really positive thing. Now, if you're wondering how we got Herman and Maria, how we helped them to get Herman to long-term care, we knew from doing a personhood tool with Herman that he had an excellent relationship with his family doctor. His family doctor was able to do house calls, but we used a fiblet strategy to tell Herman that his family doctor on this occasion was not able to come out and that Herman was going to have to go to the office. Now remember, Herman hadn't been out of that room basically for the last year, but because he had such a strong attachment with his primary care physician, he was willing to come out of the room for that and to go to the doctor's office. But he actually went to long-term care where the family physician was able to be to do a visit that day. And that really was an anchor for Herman to feel better about the transition. The whole thing wasn't as easy as I'm making it sound, but knowing who Herman was as a person and knowing about his prior relationships and his prior health made it much easier to move forward. So we have a lot more to talk about. The next video I think is gonna be about fiblets and what are they and are they ethical. That's a good one. I'd love to get your feedback on that. But if you have a chance, check out the Behavioural Supports Integrated Teams tool for transitions. It's a checklist and it's got lots of links and lots of really good practical information. I'd love to hear what you have to say about it, and I'll see you next time here on The Wrinkle.